I'm going to talk to you, a slight diversion and a light-hearted diversion. I'm going to talk to you about the Emirates Airline cable car, which obviously is a people movement device. Before I do that, I'm going to talk about the standards that apply, because believe it or not, many of you will be aware of EN 81 Part 22 that's a PR and has been for many years for incline lifts. Well, there is a difference between an incline lift and a cableway, and we've agonised for many years over the definitions between the two. But one of my pet hates is the fact that the standards for cableways and inclined cableways, in particular rail-mounted ones, are very different to the standards for incline lifts. For instance, an incline cableway, you're allowed a single rope, whereas obviously with lifts we have to have a minimum of two, don't we? And there's issues like, you know, such as that. So that is one of my pet hates. But the reason I became involved with the Emirates Airline That's better. The reason I became involved was because I started getting involved with, call them incline lifts, call them cableways. That, in fact, is defined as a cableway. The old funiculars around the UK, of which there's 27 of them, come under the cableway regulations. Now, rather like the lift regulations, the cableway industry has the Cableway Installation Directive, which came in 2004, which again is very, very different to the lift regulations, and you have to ask yourself why. For instance, when you modernise one of these things, you have to go through a stage one and a stage two process, and the stage one process is like a planning application. You have to put a formal proposal to government, in the UK to the Department for Transport, who have to look at it, consider it, decide whether it's okay. Can you imagine if we had to do that with lifts for every modernisation we did? So essentially the stage one, it asks the question, is it going to be safe? And I'll be taking you through some of the issues about that in a minute. Then the stage two process is, after you've got the permission for stage one, yep, we've built it, can you come along and check it? So a government inspector comes along and checks what you've installed. Again, can you imagine if that happened on every new lift that we installed, if there was a government department that came along? So this was the start of it for me. This photograph, in fact, is Hastings East Hill Cliff Railway in Sussex. And that, in fact, was the winner of the Elevator World photo competition this year. So the cast. The Emirates Airline runs from Greenwich on the south side of the River Thames by the O2 Arena across to Victoria Docks on the north side. It was commissioned by Transport for London. It's owned by DLR, Docklands Light Railway. It fits neatly into their network. It's very interesting because they're terrified of it because it hasn't got rails. It was built by Mace, the same company that built the Shard. The cableway was element of it was made by a company called Doppelmayr in Austria. There are, in fact, only three cable car manufacturers in the world. There's Doppelmayr in Austria, there's Leitner in Switzerland, and there's Poma in France. And between them, it's like the old days of the escalator market, really. The majors have wrapped it up. The towers were made by a company called Watson Steel because they were commissioned from a sketch by Boris, the Mayor of London. I have to say, working for Boris is extremely interesting. I can honestly say I've had more fun on this project with clothes on than anything else that's ever happened in my life. It's now operated by Mace Macro from an FM point of view, because there are specific operational requirements in the standards. And it was accepted by the DFT. My role was to act for the DFT as the legal compliance officer. So I had to go over this thing, nuts and bolts, and accept it into service. April 2011, believe it or not, planning permission. June 2012, just over a year later, it entered service. Absolutely incredible project. Went at an amazingly fast pace. Some very interesting meetings. There was very one of the real focuses was on security and it being a terrorist target. And in fact, there's a group who I'll show you later who are on call permanently to rescue people and get people down. One of the biggest risks was someone like Fathers for Justice climbing up to the top of a tower and needing to be brought down. In fact, I sat through meetings with people from other government departments who never said their name when you went round the table. Dave Cooper from DFT, and you got to these two chaps, and all they said was, "I represent the Queen." And they were the security guys, and they obviously worked for the same department because they both had the same sunglasses. So, April 2011, the base specification for this thing, 34 gondolas out on the line, they're 10-person gondolas, and the reason for them being 10-person gondolas is because if you go to 11, then the London omnibus regulations apply, which would have delayed us because it would have fallen under bus regulations. It runs at a top speed of 6 metres a second, and persons per hour, that's 2,500. So it's a fair old people mover. There are some options when it comes to cable cars. One of the lovely things working for Boris is you end up with loads of presents. You could have had one car, or you could have 34 of these. And it's really interesting, the technology is such a combination of lifts and escalators, because the line is tensioned just like an escalator's tensioned with a carriage. And obviously the cars are all very much similar to lifts. The greatest delay on this project, believe it or not, was getting the design changed to take the ski lockers off the side of the doors, because under the regulations that was a change and you had to go through the process. So the trip time at top speed is 4 minutes 14 seconds, so it's going a fair lick. In its heyday, just because it was intended to be open for the Olympics, and it was, June the 28th it opened, it carried 32,000 people one day. Absolutely incredible piece of kit. So we've got 34 person gondolas. I showed you the model there. That's a standard model. You probably recognise it from loads of big wheels around the country, in the London Eye, that sort of thing. It's a variation on those cars. It's a standard car that Doppelmayr make. 150mm rope. See, we wouldn't be allowed that in the lift industry, would we? But very interesting the way they string them. A boat went across the Thames with a small piece of rope, and from the small piece of rope they pulled a bigger piece of rope until they got a big enough piece of rope to pull the wire across. Very interesting arrangement. The river had to be shut to do that. And of course, one of the great issues with working on either side of the river is you need to get planning permission from the south side, from Greenwich, from the north side. Port of London Authority are involved, the City of London involved. You have to get all these different bodies to give you permission to do things. There's three main towers, two at 85 metres tall and one at 63 metres tall. I'll show you the reason for, someone's going to say, why didn't you just have two towers? I'll show you the reason for that in a minute. But these were all made off-site and floated in on a barge. There's four compression towers. What we mean by compression towers is the rope goes under the rollers, so it goes upwards. This is the two compression towers on the south side, and then there's another two on the north side as it approaches the station. Not too different to some large lifts. Massive drive shaft, big traction sheave. This is on the north side. Brake between the motor and the disc brake, in this case, between the motor and the gearbox, which is a cooled gearbox as well. Engineering issues. You won't be surprised that there were engineering issues. If anyone recognises this is the old East London Tunnel. Anyone remember Brunel getting into trouble digging the tunnel under the Thames? Well, no one seemed to remember that for this project. This is the East London Tunnel before it became the East London Underground Line. Serving from the Rotherhithe side, and initially the tunnel was a walk through, and it was full of shops, and eventually closed to become a railway line because it filled up with prostitutes and people sleeping in doorways. So it's a bit like Rotherhithe today, really. But what happened during that process is the tunnel was encroached and filled up with water. In fact, Brunel nearly drowned. Brunel was quite good at trying to drown himself. He had a few attempts at it in his time. But he had to go along the riverbed in a bell until he found where the encroachment was to pack it. But we had that. What we discovered, or what the civils guys discovered, was that the first 30 metres of the River Thames is nothing but slime. So the piles had to be extended beyond that to get down to bedrock. Flight path's a bit of an interesting one, because we're right on the flight path, and in fact the envelope in which the cable car sits, the top of the 85 metre towers, is only 8 metres below the emergency approach line flight into London City Airport. So again, as you can imagine, there were risk assessments, and you'll be pleased to know that there'll only be an incident every one in a million years. Let's just hope it's not tomorrow. But again, it was one of the issues that needed to be looked at. Tall ships. There's the other thing. The specification required that we got a 51-metre tall ship under the system on a high tide. And the tide varies by 3.76 metres in that area. Unfortunately, at the time the Olympics were starting, and HMS Ocean was the security base for the whole of the Olympics, as you're aware. And so she came up with the Thames, and we in fact used her as our testing and commissioning device. Quite lucky to have a real ship to do it with. Weather is the other incident. We talked about building sway yesterday, quite interestingly. The two lines are obviously quite a way apart, but the cars can touch. And at 17 mile an hour of wind, we have to wind down. We have to take the cars off the line, because essentially they just turn into demolition balls. They will actually hit each other. So we have to bring her in. So the construction phase. To build a very big crane, you need a couple of big cranes. You'll find a few slides of the cranes, because I'm absolutely in awe of this thing. Absolutely incredible monster of a crane. You see there, that's the final baby once you've been built. Made by Lieber, lifting capacity of 1,350 tonnes at 12 metres. Absolutely incredible beast. Main boom could extend from 30 to 150 metres. Speed, 1.08 kilometres an hour. Don't get stuck behind that on the M1 tonight. You'll be there forever. And a counterweight of 990 tonnes. So a huge beast. Again, as I say, I'm absolutely awestruck by this thing. And there you go, to give you an idea, that's its tracks. Absolutely massive beast. Not only that, we needed a floating one. This is Atlas. People might remember Atlas from writing the Herald of Free Enterprise when it collapsed. It rolled over, sorry. The first part of the towers, there's one tower in the river, the South Thames Tower, and the reason that's in the river was to give us the 51 metres under the line and maintain us below the flight path in. So the first stage of the tower was poured, and then after that, sections were lifted in. Absolutely incredible operation, and I have a few slides here of them going up. You see, these towers were specially commissioned, as I say, from a drawing on a postcard by Boris, believe it or not. They, in fact, in wind, they turn into incredible springs because they just want to twist. Again, that's the crane lifting sections in part. That's the view up it. Takes me 3/4 an hour to get to the top. I know I'm short and fat, but I'm glad I've given up smoking, I have to say. To keep on program, we were lifting during the night. This is a set of the roller batteries going up on one of the towers. But again, towers being constructed, 24-hour operation. This is the North Terminal, which is over on the Royal Victoria side near the Excel Centre. And you can see the Siemens Museum in the background there, the pointed building. Again, the north side, the complexity there is it was built in the drink. So again, they had to pile underneath the station to build on it. That's the main south tower on completion, just waiting for another set of roller batteries to go up there. The gondolas all came across from Austria. They're all sitting there. They're all garaged. They come off the line at night and come into the station. Very interesting because the line keeps rotating and so it can go up to 6 metres a second. But as you come into the station, they come off the line and they're driven round by tyres. On the top of the system, there's tyres that literally drag the thing round. And what that means is you can actually stop a cable car in the station to allow people in wheelchairs and whatever to get on a gondola. So say one 50 mil rope. It's a very short video, this, but one 50 mil rope going around the whole of the system. The rope actually went out the end of the factory, went for a long distance. The splicing on it was actually incredible to watch this little Austrian man come across to splice the rope. The splice actually is 63 metres of the rope. And it was the man, incredibly strong hands. It's like watching someone knitting. Absolutely incredible. Testing and commissioning. These were them out on the line for the first time. Obviously everyone's very pensive when that happens. You can see the first three going out there. Usual stuff, same as we do for a lift. Load them all up. Because we have to then measure the line to make sure that what the sag is okay and you can still get a boat underneath it on high tide. So what happens if there's a power cut? We have a power supply from the grid on the south side. We have a power supply from the grid on the north side. We have a generator on the south side and we have a generator on the north side. So security was one of their big things. And if it comes to it, you can hand wind it. So hydraulically assisted, but there's the cog in position. You can actually physically hand wind this thing. What happens if a ship loses control? That was another thing we had to consider. The reality is, the size of ship that's going to do any damage to this thing is going to be large, and it's going to run aground before it gets to there. But there was a risk that one of the refuse barges that we see on the Thames could cut adrift from a tug and come and do some damage. So £12 million was spent on this ship impact system, and within that tub to the right, it's basically a massive spring that pays out if it needs to. Other possibilities, the rope derails. Interesting, because the standard requires that there's a specific standard for evacuation of cableways, BSEN 1909, which means you have to get everyone off the system within 3 hours. So an interesting discussion yesterday that what Rory gave about the people taking ill after 15 minutes, because there is no air conditioning, but the standard allows you to be there for up to 3 hours. And I'll go through rescue in a minute. Bearing seizes, if the bearing seizes on the main traction sheave, in fact what they do is they engage another bearing to bring it back home on slow speed. So much redundancy in the system, it's incredible. Right in the middle of it, this was April 2012, 75 people got stuck in a cable car in Italy. So the balloon did go up. So we really did concentrate on evacuation. So you wonder, how do you get people out of a cable car when it really is stuck? And the answer is this. Please work.
I think it's stuck.
It's not working, is it?
It's not there.
It says media.
Does it? Ah. Do you know, well, it's interesting because it worked this morning when I tested it out. What actually happens is they come down the line. Like that, and what was going to happen when that video played is it opened up. There's a 210 foot ravine below us there, And they made all of us go over to between these two mountains in Austria, and they rescued us from the cars to prove it could happen. I know what my mum would say if someone came down to a cable car and said, we're going to abseil you out. But that is the evacuation process. But what, obviously it's very high up. The guys from Taskmaster, these are the rescue team. They come up, you can see them going down the line there, what we call the Doppelmayr flyer, which literally lets him go down the line to the top of the car and take the rescue equipment with him. That was, again, posing for us in one of the photographs. These guys are incredible. They're just mad. And there's another part of the rescue there. They literally put you in a harness, which you simply cannot fall out of, even if you try. But the issue we have over the Thames is we're over the Docklands Light Railway, we're over a road, we're over the river, which can be high tide, can be low tide, so we have mud. And in fact, if we announce an evacuation, three Thames clippers come down the line. You can see we're actually rescuing someone there to the top of a boat, which was a very interesting Sunday afternoon, I have to say. Nearing handover, so it started to appear, first new line to appear on the London Underground system as a new line as a whole, since the Jubilee line. Obviously, it's now there. Off the back of this, I've become involved in other cable car systems, which is very interesting. This is Dersey Island in Southern Ireland near Cork, which is basically a shed on a washing line. You laugh. Animals have priority. Animals have priority to Dersey Island. Absolutely true, and not only the cows, the sheep as well. And you just see in the top left-hand corner there, by that sign, if it gets too windy and you get a bit nervous, there's a bottle of holy water. And there's a prayer there as well. So you've got to love the Irish. And the other one I'm working on at the moment is in Lagos. Lagos is gridlocked all day long. It takes forever to get into Lagos. And so there's going to be this new cable car system, 13 kilometres long, to take people into Lagos centre itself. And finally, while you ask questions, and hopefully this video will work. This is the first run. I was on the first run. So you'll get a complete loop on that. So while that's running, if anyone's got any questions, please ask. Thank you.